After 11, we have on the phone the Assemblyman, Assemblyman Eduardo Garcia. Good morning, sir.
Good morning. Good morning. Thank you for having us.
Well, it's nice of you to be so patient. Let everybody know the Assemblyman called 6 minutes ago. He's been sitting there listening to the news like everybody else. How is everything going with you, sir?
Well, look, we are doing what the governor and the president has asked us to do, and practice what we're referring to as physical distancing, making sure that we are remaining 6 feet away from individuals and in smaller groups of 10 or less, but really working out of the kitchen here at home, taking calls like this, as well as ensuring that our constituents throughout the district are receiving accurate, on-time information related to the actions that the state of California is taking and resources that are being made available for those who are being impacted by COVID-19. And so hoping that we can share some of those things today in this interview.
We will do that in just a minute. In fact, I think we're going to blend it right into it. Today is Census Day. What does that mean to everybody?
Wow, what a unique opportunity to talk about the census given the current circumstances. Now more than ever, I think it means that by us ensuring that every single person is counted, we ensure that the federal government allocates the adequate amount of resources to this region. And it's a perfect example, the issue that we're facing with today as it relates to medical services, making sure that we have the capacity at our hospitals, at our clinics, making sure that our schools have the ability to prepare future workforce for the medical sector. I couldn't tell you how much more important the message is today than ever that we have to make ourselves be counted. Aside from the areas of the medical workforce and investing into the medical infrastructure, we're talking about roads, bridges, we're talking about infrastructure that is critical to our region. And at the same time, it really focuses on representation, and we know how important representation is at all levels of government. And these numbers that are collected by the census determine all of the above that has just been mentioned.
A lot of people don't talk about this, but I would think that a good census would help your job out a lot. You, as a representative of your district, part of your job is to get stuff for your district, and you got to get funding for that stuff. And if you have a good census, a full accounting, that would probably make your job a bit easier.
You're absolutely correct. I always simplify the work that we do with two very important points, and that is introduce and pass legislation and support legislation that is in the interest of our region and bring home the money. And being able to point to the need via population growth, we're able to tell that story. And again, the census is about making sure that everyone's counted for the purpose of the allocation of resources proportionally. And so today, more than ever, although there are other pressing matters before us that are consuming all of the air today, we need to remind ourselves that the census is fundamentally important to helping us prepare, react to situations like the one that we're facing today with COVID-19.
I was going to say the census is also important in that regard, in that the funding for COVID-19 repercussions would be a lot easier.
That is correct. And knowing the $2 trillion stimulus economic package that has just been forward, much of how that gets distributed is determined by prior statistics and numbers that are in place today. So making sure, again, that even though we have a lot of other priorities take precedent today, reminding Imperial County constituents that the census is extremely important for the reasons that we've already mentioned.
Okay, how about updating us on the statewide COVID-19 situation?
Absolutely. I think most importantly, there are three initiatives, executive orders that the governor has taken on The first one is assisting renters and homeowners with the issue of payments. Now, that only works if we can ensure communication between homeowners and their banks. The major five banks that exist that provide home loans have agreed to work with homeowners and their mortgages. We also, through the executive order, have put a stop to any potential evictions for those who are renters. But again, that only works if there is a justification tied to economic impact caused by COVID-19. And so we also have to make sure that the homeowners that are renting, the owners of apartments that are renting, also have access to capital through the Small Business Association, who's providing loans to make people whole during this particular time. The other is expediting the unemployment process. We need to make sure that those who have been impacted by the COVID-19 situation and are out of work and are staying home, as the executive order has asked us to, have the ability to apply quickly and have access to those dollars that they so much deserve through the work that they've done along the way. And the third, I would say, is focusing on making sure that we can get homeless individuals off the streets and into temporary housing so that we could eliminate the possibility of spreading the COVID-19 in our community. Those are three really important actions that the governor has taken. And, of course, continuing to really hit the soundboard on the issue of physical distancing. I know the terminology has been social distancing, but really we continue to socialize through other methods, whether it be the social media, telephone calls. We want to make sure that we have physical distancing in order to prevent the spread. There are now confirmed 38 cases in Imperial County. I believe that there are some pending to be determined, and the numbers will increase. The numbers will increase, and how we flatten that curve is by us doing our part. If we're able to stay home and not part of the essential services list of jobs, that we do so. But again, making sure that we're reaching out to all of the entities that are providing support if you're unemployed, if you are in a situation that you find yourselves without a home, and or those who need support because they're renters and or need to pay a mortgage, and the first of the month is now before them. So we have to make sure that people know where to access these resources. And our office continues to be of service. We are taking these calls every single day. I want to tell you the phone number for our office in Imperial County is 760-355-8656. I want to make sure that people are aware that we are taking calls from 9 to 5 to be able to assist people in Imperial County with any questions, concerns that they may have regarding COVID-19 or any of the resources that we just mentioned just now.
Okay, and I'm sure, I don't know if you heard, I'm sure you did. County Board of Supervisors yesterday pretty much supported two of the things that you mentioned, the eviction situation in Imperial County in the unincorporated areas, and also the homeless. They distributed the funds received for the homeless situation.
That's great. You know, over $700,000 have been delivered to the county to address this urgency of getting homeless folks off the streets and into some temporary housing. I anticipate more resources will come in our direction for those purposes. But the action that was taken by the County of Imperial was an important one to really set the tone for the entire community that this is what we need to be implementing during this public health crisis that's before us. At the same time, it's important to acknowledge, given that we are a border region, the actions that have been taken by the mayor in Mexicali and the governor of Baja California will complement the work that's being done in Imperial County and the state of California in order to flatten the curve in our region. It's fundamentally important that what we do on this side of the border, we recognize that has an impact on the other side and vice versa. So we want to really acknowledge these actions that have been taken because it will save lives. And again, I can't say this enough. We have to remain home if we're not part of the essential services jobs list.
Yeah, kind of nice, though, that to hear that everybody's working together right now anyway.
You know, right now there isn't an issue of that the Republican or Democrat. There is an issue of saving lives. And the federal government is working with the state government. The state is communicating with our counties, and our counties are disseminating the information and enforcing, you know, the policies that are being adopted. Is it a smooth process? No. But is it working to the extent that we're able to get the word out, the message out? Absolutely. One of the things that, you know, the governor has said is that the California is going to take the lead. Whether the federal government is sending support or not in a timely manner. One example was ventilators were received to the state of California. Not a single one worked. The governor took it upon himself to reach out to Silicon Valley, and in 72 hours, those ventilators were working back in Los Angeles, and we're expecting to be able to get more ventilators to distribute them across the state of California. I mean, really, the governor has taken a really strong leadership role, as he should, in making sure that we can prevent any lives from being lost as a result of not being ready, as a result of not having the resources. And, you know, I got to give it to the folks there locally for taking that action at the county board of supervisor level. It's an extremely important message to send to all of the residents of Imperial County that this is a serious matter and that we have to really practice what we're calling physical distancing in order to be able to flatten the curve.
And it's nice that everybody's working together so we can get that flattened. Before we leave the subject, can you tell us some good news about this? I mean, we're hearing all the negative stuff. Don't sugarcoat it. But is there some good stuff we can talk about?
Well, look, one of the things is that we can say that California acted in a timely manner, and that we could honestly say that we probably will have saved, you know, thousands of lives because of that. We have a lot of work to do still. You know, every day you turn on the news and you hear what's happening in New York and Illinois and Detroit and other parts of the country. But when they talk about California, they refer to California as a place that's been moving aggressively to tell Californians to stay home if they're not part of the essential services job list, telling Californians that there are resources being put forward, whether you're a small business or you're a person who's been unemployed as a result of this. And we're also seeing a collaboration between the private and public sector of California stepping up, stepping in, as the governor says, to meet the moment. So we want to make sure that, again, just Californians know that they have a role to play, and making sure that they stay healthy starts with trying to stay physically distant from people outside of their family nucleus. And at the same time, making sure that when you're going out, that you're covering your face, and ultimately just doing the things that are necessary when you're out and back home with your family. So there are some positive things that I think we can say that are coming from the actions that are being taken by the state government, our county government like Imperial, who took that action yesterday. And we have to be optimistic, have faith, and ultimately know that this will pass us, but really will have taught us things, an important lesson about how do we prepare for a pandemic crisis like this throughout the state of California and in counties like Imperial County.
There is word from the officials, the scientists and stuff, that say the aggressiveness of California actually saved us from being a New York-type situation.
And that's what I'm referring to. And really, at this point, what we have to do is just continue to stay on the course, follow the rules. I know that it's difficult. I know, you know, we're home. We have a five-year-old. We've turned into a part-time kindergarten teacher. And so, you know, between that and the work that we have to do and making sure that we are being responsive to the constituents, of course, it gets complicated. But nevertheless, I think that it's in the interest of our well-being, our public health for Californians. And really what we're trying to accomplish here is making sure that we save lives. And by staying home, we actually are able to do that.
Yeah, we have a three-year-old at my house that just driving us crazy. And anyway, I understand, I don't know how accurate this is, but I understand that April is considered the peak month. With the COVID, they're looking that for April to be the peak month. It should be downhill after that.
What we're being told is that we will see an increase in infections across the country during the month of April. Yeah. But what we also will see is how effective, you know, the actions that we're taking early on will be. For example, when we see a spike in other parts of the country, we could potentially see the curve begin to flatten out in California. Now, over the course of the last few days, we've seen a significant spike of intensive care unit attentions. I think it's tripled in some instances, and the number of infected people also increased significantly. So we will see how effective, you know, our aggressive stay-home policies have been. We will now be going into the third week or fourth week, and so ultimately it will be telling about how we've responded to this crisis. But really, it really comes back down to the local community, how serious we're taking the issue and whether or not we are exercising, you know, the directives that are being told. Again, this isn't an issue about Republicans or Democrats. This is about saving lives. This is an issue about public health and well-being. And we have to keep that in mind every single day that we're being asked to stay home, practice physical distancing, and making sure that, you know, we're providing the necessary information and resources to the community on real time, so that we're able to ensure that they are safe in their homes and with their families.
Okay, sir, I'm gonna let you go. We have covered a lot on the COVID-19. Several other topics I would hope you would call back sometime. We can cover the other issues. We'll talk about the new River Salt Sea and stuff like that. But we've taken a lot of your time on the COVID situation. Do you think, before you go, do you think if it is a peak this month, are we ready for recovery, or is it too premature to even talk about that?
I think, you know, what I want to say is that the focus of the legislature will be economic recovery and investing into the healthcare infrastructure and workforce this coming year. I've been told that what we will focus on is a budget and public policy proposals that focus on those two areas. We hope that the federal government will work closely with us to be able to put forward additional resources for economic recovery, put people back to work, making sure that everyone is healthy, and ultimately that our economies are stable. We have been riding a good, stable economy with a tremendous amount of job growth that's been led by California in the nation. This is an interruption. This will be a bump along the way, but I think collectively we'll be able to regroup and make sure that you get the economy back going. And of course, places like Imperial County are unique in the sense that we have to do more. We have to double down our efforts to ensure that we have a good economy and people working there and in our border region in order for people to thrive. So we've got a lot of work to do. I think for now the focus is stay home, stay safe, save lives, exercise the physical distancing policies, and really making sure that people know about the resources that are available for them in order to ensure that they're able to put some food on the table and continue to have a roof over their head. That's the focus right now. We look forward to connecting with you again to talk about the other policy issues that you raised. And thank you again for allowing me to share these moments with the people of Imperial County. We appreciate everything that happens in Imperial County. And again, I just wanted to remind folks that our office is available to provide any answers to the questions that they may have at 760-355-8656. Again, thank you so much for allowing me this airtime to provide this information.
Thank you, sir. I hope we've covered everything that everybody wanted to know. Assemblyman Eduardo Garcia, District 56. Thank you for calling, sir.
Thank you again.
Okay, we're ready to get back into it now.
All right. And now, more of the best oldies on the radio with George Gale.
We're just trying to entertain people, and morality's just going to get in the way.
AM
1230. That's hilarious.
KXO.
Hello.
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 Hello?